doing a contract that's got a dispute clause in it, you want to have some sort of escalation, some sort of opportunity to talk directly to the key decision maker before it gets escalated out to mediation or arbitration or goes to litigation.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome back to Entrepreneurship 101 and our negotiations lecture with Michael Erdle. Before I introduce Michael, just a few announcements. If you haven't had your stamp card stamped yet, we do close the registration desk at about 6:15, so you can sneak out, get it stamped, and come back in. Shout out to our webcast attendees from NORCAD Innovation Factory and Haltech. Welcome back. Always good to have you. Our Upstart competition, we are in the height of our review process. Very exciting. We're looking forward to making the announcements about the second stage, the applicants who have gone on to the second stage by the 14th of this month. Our Lived It lecture is next week with Ted Riley, who is currently CEO of Technologies Innovation Group Canada. And if you're familiar with Alliance Atlantis Communications, which was established out of a merger in 1998 and ultimately was sold to Canwest Global Communications and a subsidiary of Goldman Sachs. He's coming in to speak, Ted Riley's coming in to speak next week and to share his story as an entrepreneur with all of you. So that's going to be pretty exciting. And then the week after, we have our Meet the Entrepreneurs for our life sciences and healthcare practice. So one other announcement, our upcoming best practices event is on the importance of Common Core alignment for your EdTech startup. And it's the first of our education innovation series in the best practice series. So we have the Common Core alignment, we have sales, and we have business model. And those are three parts to the series. And that's on Tuesday, February 18th. And it's $15 early bird registration and $20 after that. Now, to get to the meat of the matter, Michael Erdle is a managing partner of Deeth Williams Wall LLP, a leading Toronto technology and intellectual property law firm. He has practiced primarily in the areas of information technology and intellectual property law for more than 20 years. He's a qualified mediator and arbitrator and is a member of the ADR Institute of Ontario and the ADR Institute of Canada. We're very glad to have him back again. Please join me in welcoming Michael.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm glad to be back and thank all of you for coming out tonight. I guess the weather's a little bit better than it has been in some of the past weeks, but I appreciate everybody coming tonight. I am going to talk about two things mainly, negotiation and conflict resolution. Most of my talk is about negotiation, and hopefully some useful tips and strategies for you. And at the end, then I'll talk about what to do when the negotiations break down and you have a problem with a conflict. So just by show of hands here, who thinks that they're a good negotiator? Right? Very small number of you. I'll tell you right off the bat, you are actually much better negotiators than you think, and I will tell you why. So negotiation is a process, and I'm going to talk a lot tonight about some of the elements of that process. A really good negotiation, successful negotiation, is a structured conversation. It's an ongoing dialogue. And an exchange of information. And it's a means to an end. You want to agree about something. And to be a really good negotiator, you need to know at the beginning where you want to be at the end. We negotiate all the time. We negotiate about everything. We do it without thinking about it. We learn how to do it when we're about 1 or 2 years old, when we learn to speak. Because the first thing we do when we learn to speak is negotiate with our parents. Generally by lying down on the ground and screaming and kicking our feet, and then we get a little bit better than that over time, and then you become a CEO and you go back to what you did when you were two and you lie down and you kick your feet and scream. So we're going to talk about three things to start with. And that's interests and rights and power. And there are the three levels of negotiation. And let me tell you what I mean about that. I look at them as a set of steps and negotiations often escalate. And conflicts in particular escalate. So if you're not successful early on in negotiation in talking about your interests, you go to rights, what does the legal contract say, or what does some other right say, and then to power at the top, and that's just simply, I have the final say, we're going to do it my way. And so let me just, as a quick example, my teenage daughter wants to borrow the car. Well, the interest-based negotiation is, well, if you let me use the car to go out tonight, I'll drive my sister to hockey and I'll drop you off where you want to go, and then I can have the car, and we work out something based on our mutual interests of who needs to get where and who gets to use the car. The rights-based version of that is, well, you promised me that if I cleaned my room, did whatever, did the chores, I could use the car. And the power-based answer to that is, no, it's my car. You can't have the keys. Forget it. Too bad. Don't bother me anymore. And so we'll talk about where those different strategies develop and where they end up. The power-based strategy is very effective. It works perfectly until the point where it doesn't work at all anymore. And if you're a dictator in Syria or Libya, you know what I mean. You've got absolute power until someone else comes along and takes it all away from you, and maybe you end up dead in a ditch somewhere. It's maybe not the best long-term strategy if you risk losing your power. So here are some of the strategies that people can use if they have power, and some of the characteristics of those kinds of negotiations and those kinds of conflicts. They're very adversarial, and they're completely win-lose. They have a potentially very negative impact on the future relationship, because as soon as the person that you've used the power against has some power of their own, they're going to use it back at you, and you lose out. The right strategy is based on things like contracts. And I've worked as a lawyer for 25 years before I started doing mediation and arbitration. So, I mean, this is a level that I'm very comfortable with, and other people who are very rights-based are comfortable with. And so in a lot of organizations, everything's built around rules, policies, procedures. This is what we did before. If we did it this way last time, we have to do it this way next time, because that's the fair thing to do. And again, the characteristics of that are fairly adversarial, because you are inevitably testing the limits of the rights. If you have a conflict over rights, it becomes very expensive to determine who's right, who's wrong, what those rights are. You end up going to court, you go to arbitration, you go to some sort of a tribunal or adjudicator. Even in the workplace, you end up before a decision maker who's going to say, these are the rights and these are what we're going to do. And you often then leave with ill feeling, and somebody is going to be dissatisfied with the outcome. Interest-based negotiation takes a different approach. And the characteristics of that are at least an effort to look for a win-win resolution. It's a collaborative process rather than adversarial. And it's focused on building trust and building a positive relationship for the future. And the ways that you try to do that is to try to identify what the interests are, what what's important in this particular negotiation or this particular relationship. There's a certain amount of honesty and disclosure required, more than in other situations probably. But you're looking to maximize the results for everybody, not just for yourself. You want to maximize the results for yourself, of course, but you also want to see if, at the same time, you can improve the result for the others who are involved in this. And it requires an ongoing relationship. It's important that there be at least the prospect of an ongoing relationship to make all of this effort worthwhile. So here's a very complicated, complicated looking, but simple in reality graph. And that, the message in this is that as the costs in any dispute process, any conflict or any negotiation go up, the actual amount of control that you have over the outcome goes down. If you're problem solving, negotiating, very little cost, you spend some time, and you have complete control over the outcome because you're going to agree or you're not going to agree, but it's up to you. And you can control what it is you're going to agree to. Mediation and conciliation are a form of interest-based dispute resolution, and I'll come to that later on. But it's fairly low cost, and you have a great deal of control. But once you start getting into the rights-based process or dispute resolution, the cost goes way up. You have to hire a lawyer. You have to go through a process. And the amount of control you have goes down at the same time. Someone else is going to make the decision for you. And then the power-based process is extremely expensive if it doesn't work. And think about countries going to war over disputes that they try to resolve through force of power. Unilateral action, threats, all of those types of processes are enormously expensive. And once you press the button and, you know, launch the missile, the rest of it is out of your control. You've got no more control over what's going to happen after that. So what I just love this cartoon, so I just threw it in here. The golden rule is whoever has the gold makes the rules. And when we're talking about entrepreneurship and we're talking about companies, it's very true. I mean, whoever has the money has a lot of influence over who needs the money. And we'll come back to some of the negotiating interests and leverage points in a minute. But key message in preparing for any negotiation is look for ways to de-escalate the negotiation process. So if somebody is looking to exercise their power, even if it's just power over money, look for ways to de-escalate that so it's more rights-based and not just strictly power-based. And if it's a rights-based discussion, then you can try to de-escalate that and make it an interest-based discussion, because that's likely to be more productive in the long run. One of the questions that a lot of people ask is, well, what in negotiating, do I have any responsibility to negotiate in good faith? What does that mean, to negotiate in good faith? And these are two quotes. It's the only time I'll refer to any legal thing in this presentation at all. But we've got the Ontario Court of Appeal, who says that you have to respect the legitimate interests of the other party. And they talk about honesty, fairly, and reasonably. And the Supreme Court of Canada says that if there's some sort of imbalance in negotiation, and I'm going to talk about some of the imbalances and some of the strategies, but you do have an obligation to negotiate in good faith. So what is this about? And one of the things that a lot of people in negotiating, and particularly when it comes to legal negotiations, is you often see, well, it's obligation to act honestly and in good faith. There's two different things there. Honesty means simply that you're not going to lie. Legal terms, we call it misrepresentation. If you lie on a job application or in your resume, your employer can fire you simply because you lied. If you lie to potential investors in your company, if you misrepresent anything that is significant to their decision, there's a whole lot of consequences that out of that. So the basic standard is tell the truth. The good faith standard is a little bit higher than that. And good faith comes into play where you've got some code of ethics, you've got a relationship, a business relationship, employers and employees, some sort of contract that requires you to live up to a bit higher standard. It's not enough to just not lie. You have to actually act in good faith and treat their interests kind of on a par with your own. And then the highest standard is the fiduciary, and that's what the standard a lawyer has to follow when they're dealing with their clients. A doctor has to act in the best interests of their patient, not in their own best interests. And if you're a doctor, you can't order a whole bunch of useless medical tests simply because you get a payment from the lab for every test you order. You have to act in the best interests of your patient. From a business perspective, it's really important to understand that if you're a corporate director, you have to act in the best interests of the corporation, not in your own best interest. And that affects how you negotiate and how you deal with other people, not just your own company, but people outside your company. So about the shortest course in negotiation ethics that you'll ever get. But it underlies a lot of what I'm going to say about how to be effective as a negotiator. Because I think that living up to the higher standard of ethics in a negotiation in the long run is going to put you further ahead. So, what about negotiation? What are the steps? What's the process? There's two kinds of negotiations that take place. And we'll call them distributing value and creating value. A lot of negotiations, you want to buy a car, you want to get the cheapest price, that's about distributing value. If I get a better price, it's better for me, worse for the car dealer. There is an opportunity there to create value. It's just simply price. The distributing value type of negotiations are fairly opportunistic. I'm going to get the best deal that I can today because that's all I really care about today. The other types of creating value negotiations are more about problem solving and longer term relationships. Now, the buying a car example is a good one for that as well, because if I'm the person selling the car, if I'm the dealer or the salesperson who's selling cars, and I want to have people come back and buy more cars from me, come back every 3 years and buy a new car, it's not strictly opportunistic. There may be some incentive for me to actually create value, and create value in a relationship with a repeat customer. And there's lots of companies, there's lots of businesses that operate that way, that negotiating price with customers. The old Eaton's, when it long time ago still existed, department store, and their policy of good satisfactory or your money refunded is a perfect example of that. They're willing to give up the money from this sale because they figure that a happy customer is going to buy more stuff from them in the future. There's really nothing in it for them, that kind of return policy, except the future relationship. Identifying issues is important. You have to, in any business negotiations in particular, not only know what you want and need, but really understand what the other side wants and needs. Try to develop a better understanding of that. And the best negotiators I know spend most of their time trying to figure out what the other party is looking for and how to try to satisfy that without giving up anything that's important to themselves. So we'll talk about interests, and the point to remember here, and I'll come back to this later in more detail, but there's three kinds of interests in any negotiation. Parties always have some interests in common, otherwise they wouldn't be there in the first place. There's some complementary interests, and there's almost always conflicting interests. And you have to identify and deal with all three of those. You also have to understand the difference between interests and positions. Positions are just negotiation strategy. You have to understand the difference between needs and wants. The needs, the real needs, are the underlying interests. The wants, that's the negotiating position. The other thing to be effective in negotiation is to separate the people from the problem. That's a great concept in a book that called Getting to Yes, which I'll mention later, and I'll mention some others as well at the end of the presentation. But what they say is to be soft on the person and hard on the problem. And that means you don't attack the person. You're not successful in a negotiation by saying, you are a bad person, you are stupid, you're wrong. You can be soft on the person and develop that kind of personal relationship and still be hard on the problem by focusing on, this is what I see as the flaw in your position, or this is why I can't agree to what you're asking for, or whatever the particular issue is. When you're negotiating, always look for other options. Often I see negotiations reach an impasse or fail completely because everybody's too focused on what they had as their list of possibilities going in, and they completely miss other options that could solve the whole thing if they were open to them. Look for objective alternatives. And particularly when you're stuck on a negotiation, someone says, this is the way that it has to be. If you can find some other objective standard, some objective alternative, some other company does it this way, or there's some other source of information, that can be really useful just to get people nudged in a different direction. Best alternative to a negotiated agreement, see, I can't say it, which is why they always abbreviate it to BATNA. And WATNA is the worst alternative to a negotiated agreement. So there's always an alternative. What are they? What's the best alternative? Because whatever we negotiate here has to be better than the best alternative. Otherwise, we're not going to have a deal. But also remember, what's the worst alternative? And particularly in a situation where there's a conflict that has to be resolved, what's the worst that could possibly happen if we don't come to an agreement here? Because sometimes, you know, the best alternative is anything that's better than the worst alternative. If it's possible, look for a win-win solution. It's not always possible, but we'll come back to the idea of complementary and common interests later. Often it is possible. Communication, as I said at the beginning, negotiation's a process. So communication and trust are the bedrock of that. Lack of trust always leads to a result that's less than the best possible result. Because it forces you into a win-lose kind of situation. And negotiation is a way to create trust. So that successful negotiations will lead to increased trust and will allow you to decide whether trust is justified or not. So let me, trivial example, but if you're negotiating bedtime with a child, they always want to stay up, you know, an extra 15 minutes, extra half hour. And so you agree, you say, okay, you can stay up an extra half hour, you can whatever, read in bed, you have to turn the light out at the end of the half hour, and I'll be up to check. 35 minutes later, you come and check. There's two possibilities there. The light's out, the kid's done what they said they're going to do, or it's not. And so what do you do in your negotiation? Well, it's fairly simple. If the light's out, you know, kiss goodnight, and you're set for the next night and the next night after that. But probably not the first time, you know, the light's still on, right? And so you simply say, well, that's too bad, because you could have stayed up an extra half hour tomorrow night too, but now you can't because you didn't do what you promised to do. And they'll beg and plead, and you'll say, no, absolutely not. And then the third night, you can say, well, okay, let's try it again. And that's the negotiation in the building trust. Well, what do you think will happen the third night? How many people think, well, maybe they've learned a lesson and the light'll be off after half an hour? Maybe not. You know, there's a few who think that. You do it again and you do it again, and eventually you know whether you've got some trust there. And the negotiation you can consider to be successful. Selfish works fine in a winner-take-all, one-time negotiation. You know, I'm going to go buy a used car from somebody. I'm never going to see them again. I really don't care about anything other than I got the cheapest price possible. But most things in life aren't like that, and nothing in creating a business is like that. Most negotiations involve some sort of continuing relationship. So what about a series of negotiations? There's a huge amount of research that's been done in game theory about about what is the best negotiation strategy. And this is it. It's called tit for tat. And so there's four conditions. First of all, you start off nice. You cooperate at the beginning, in the first round. Then you retaliate. If the other person isn't nice, then the next round, you retaliate. You forgive quickly, and you're generous. So you cooperate unless and until you're provoked. And these games are played with a series of rewards. So if the two cooperate, they both get more together than they would get if each individual wins the game. And they're very simply binary, and you play multiple rounds. But you always cooperate until you're provoked. If you're provoked, you retaliate immediately, and then you immediately go back to cooperating if they cooperate next time. And you communicate that this is what you're going to do, and you do it. And you have to continue the game long enough for that pattern to affect the other side's behavior. And there's been a huge number of simulations done with all kinds of different strategies. And consistently, that is the one that's most successful in any long-term series. So you've got different negotiating styles. You can focus on winning, or focus on the content, or you can focus on the relationship. If you have little focus on either of those things, you have a situation of win-lose, or probably even lose-lose. And if you can focus on both of those things, the relationship and the content, the benefits of whatever is being negotiated, that's where you have a win-win situation. One strategy, and everybody should think about what their own negotiating strategy is, because you probably fall into one of these stereotypes, or you tend to. A lot of people just avoid any kind of conflict, any kind of negotiations. They run away from it and they hope for the best. That's a very low content and low relationship kind of strategy. Eventually, whoever you're dealing with gets fed up and they just leave. There's the people that are hyper-competitive. These are the win at all costs. They don't care about the long-term relationship. They just want to get the most out of this that they can. There's the people that accommodate. They'll agree to anything. Just about, as long as it's, you know, marginally beneficial. The relationship is the most important thing. We've got to preserve that at all costs. So they don't exactly avoid the conflict or the negotiation, but they're not very tough on it either. In the middle, there's the people that compromise. And a lot of us figure, well, that's what we have to do. We've got to compromise. We'll give and take a little. Compromise isn't good, though, because if you compromise too much, then the next time there's some resentment. You don't want to compromise again. Well, I compromised on this last time. You know, last time we went to see the movie that you wanted to see. This time we have to see the movie I want to see. The real strategy, the real best strategy, is to collaborate, which is not compromising, which is focusing on the content and the relationship to the same extent, and looking for both, looking for a solution that satisfies both those things. And so that's what we're talking about in terms of negotiation styles. The collaborative style, overall, in the long run, you might run against somebody who can just out-bargain you and drive the price down, and the collaborative style doesn't work with them. But overall, the collaborative approach is going to produce consistently better results than any of the others. Including, you know, compromise, we'll just saw it off in the middle kind of approach, which seems easy but is less productive in the long run. So that's kind of the win-win approach. So how do we deal with some of these? We talked about power negotiation, power-based negotiation, and some of these are the classic ploys. and we'll talk a little bit about how to deal with those. So one of the great negotiation strategies people think is, well, you make some extreme claim, and then you're going to, you know, make small concessions, and you'll get a good result. The way to respond to that is to be is the tit for tat approach that I talked about earlier. You make equally small concessions. So, you know, you think something's worth $100, they ask for $1,000. Okay, I'll give you 10. And then you slice and dice it till you get to the 100 that it's really worth. They may have a different view of what it's worth, but if it's just a negotiating strategy, you can always do that. The take it or leave it strategy, the best counter to that is just ignore the take it or leave it. Just make a counter offer. I don't accept either of your choices. Or just walk away. Maybe it's a bluff. It's easy. I mean, everybody's done that with, negotiating with somebody in a shop, and you turn to walk out the door, they don't let you leave. Unreciprocated offers, you never, never negotiate against yourself. If you make an offer, wait for a serious counteroffer. If they come back and say, well, that's not good enough, you have to do better than that. The answer is, well, what do you suggest? What do you think it should be? But get something on the table. It may be ridiculous and you'll never accept it, but get something, because if you put another offer on the table, well, you're just undermining yourself. Threats and warnings. If you don't agree to this, something terrible is going to happen. A counter threat is not productive. Don't get trapped into that game, because that just escalates it and it doesn't get anywhere. The way to deal with that is to attack the underlying assumption. If we don't agree to this, something terrible will happen. Well, I don't know. What makes you think something terrible is going to happen? Why do you think that's going to happen and not something else? What do you, how do we avoid that happening? Undermine the threat. Attacking alternatives. Why do you have a problem with this? One of the classic, negotiations is, that's just a ridiculous offer. That's a stupid idea. We could never do that. Why? Well, what's wrong with that? And start the discussion rather than saying, they say your idea is stupid, that you don't counter with, well, your idea is even more stupid. So, I skipped one. The good cop, bad cop is a great strategy. So use the good cop. And always negotiate with the boss. If somebody says, well, if it were up to me, I'd give you the moon, but it's not up to me. So-and-so's got to sign off on this. Okay, great. Go get them to sign off on it. I'll wait. Common interest. So parties want the same things, and that's fairly simple. Workplace. Everybody wants to avoid strikes and grievances and work stoppages because it costs both of them money. So there's a common interest in resolving things and carrying on. There's complementary interests in any kind of negotiation, any kind of conflict situation. So you want different things, but they're not mutually exclusive. So the company wants more productivity, higher profits. The workers want better pensions or higher pay. Those aren't mutually exclusive. More profits, more productivity can equal higher pay. And conflicting interests. So company wants to reduce labor costs and the workers want to be paid more. Well, I mean, those are mutually exclusive. I mean, if the object is to simply reduce labor costs, then you can't pay people more. If the company's objective is to go back one, is to increase productivity and make more money, well, maybe you can pay people more, as long as you're still increasing the productivity and making more money after you pay them more. So, common interests, complementary interests, look for those in the negotiation and look for ways to deal with the conflicting interests. Communication is the key. I said that already. You can be assertive and empathetic at the same time, and effective negotiators are both. They stick to their guns about the real interests and objectives in the negotiation, but they're empathetic and sympathetic to the other side's perspective, point of view. You know, I hear what you're saying, I understand why that's important, but I can't agree to that because, and maybe we should talk about some other way, maybe we should think about some other way of trying to satisfy both of us. That's still assertive, but doesn't try to cut somebody off at the knees. And so what you say is often is just as important as how you say it. Tone and body language are essential in the negotiation. There's a lot of emotion in negotiations. Things can get heated, and all of us have instant reactions at an emotional level to things people say. Before our conscious brain processes it, our unconscious brain reacts to it, and we get angry. And when we get angry, we stop listening, and we stop thinking, and we just react. And part of negotiating is to try to keep that in check and to deal with the conflict in a productive way. So understanding and recognition, and that's not the same thing as compromising and conceding. Saying, I understand, I appreciate what you're saying and why you're saying it and what you're looking for, that's very different from saying, I agree with you. There's a lot of cultural issues in negotiations, and it's kind of beyond the scope of this, but in some situations, people will nod and say yes, and they don't mean yes. All they mean is, I hear what you're saying, and I absolutely reject it. But I'm being polite, so I'm nodding and saying yes. You have to understand that about culture and perspective. And there's even a certain amount of gender difference in that as well. It's important to recognize it. There's all kinds of negotiation styles and culture that affect all of this stuff. But understand that kind of what you're saying or what you appear to be saying when you're listening to people or talking to them is very important. Listening is way more important than talking. If I, have kind of a formula, if you're negotiating, you should spend at least two or three times or more time listening than you do talking. All of us want to talk and want to, put our arguments out there. And often we stop listening. Halfway through what somebody is saying, we start thinking about what we're going to say in response, and we completely stop listening to what they're saying. Develop an active listening. I hear you saying this. Is that right? Is this what you mean? Is this what you really want? Ask questions. Acknowledge the other person's perspective. Acknowledge that you understand what they're saying, even if you're disagreeing with it. be open to other options I mentioned early, but also be pragmatic about it. If there are other options, be ready to accept what the best available option is. It might not be what you were looking for originally, but it may be better than all the other alternatives that you have. I've been involved in a lot of negotiations. I've done a lot of work over the years with entrepreneurs, with inventors, with software developers, with creative people. And often they're so fixed on their goals, on their, if this is their baby, they can never, ever bring themselves to say yes to anything. And, they will negotiate things to death until finally whoever they're talking to is just so fed up with it that they say, oh, forget it, and they're gone. And there was a viable option on the table, and they just couldn't bring themselves to say yes and accept it. So be open to the best available option. So in conflict resolution, you want to match the process to the business goals. And I'll talk a little bit about what these alternatives are all about. I'll start kind of at the bottom of this slide with facilitation. Facilitation is just an informal, inexpensive way to bring in a neutral third party, somebody who has no vested interest in this, to help focus and guide the discussion. To try to, a lot of negotiations fail just because they get derailed on one or two issues or you reach an impasse. The facilitation can help to open up the discussion and come to some sort of resolution. It's particularly good in a group context. One-on-one negotiations are fairly easy to manage, where you've got a larger group, different stakeholders, if you will, different interests, all being representative. Having somebody to facilitate that discussion and make it happen is very useful. Mediation is a bit more formal, but it's a private kind of dispute resolution. It's quicker and cheaper than litigation and arbitration. But it has a little bit more structure to it, and it's usually focused on particular issues, a particular conflict, a particular dispute that needs to be resolved. Arbitration is a private kind of adjudication. An arbitrator, the distinction, and a lot of people don't appreciate this, is that the distinction is the arbitrator, like litigation in a court, the arbitrator decides. They make a binding decision. In mediation or facilitation, the mediator or facilitator, they don't decide anything. All they do is they facilitate the discussion and help the parties come to a decision. Litigation is the most expensive. It's also public. You've got very little control over the time and expense involved. Once something goes to litigation, you're basically handing it over to your lawyer, and your only role in that is to keep writing checks. So back to the slide that I used earlier, this is where kind of litigation and arbitration fit into the scheme of things versus facilitation and mediation. And this is why the two are interest-based and they're more collaborative. Mediation, facilitation, litigation and arbitration are more rights-based and adversarial. So I kind of got ahead of myself a little bit with the slides. I already talked about facilitation and what kind of process it is. And there's all kinds of ways to organize facilitation that's useful. And I've used it with startup companies where all of the founders are having problems simply deciding what the roles and responsibilities are and who's responsible for what and communicating. They rushed into it so quickly that they never sat back and figured out who's doing what. And having a facilitator organize that. Or in a partnering situation or a joint, some sort of joint venture R&D situation, it can be useful. Mediation's more formal. As I mentioned, the mediator does not decide things for you. They just guide the process. There's two kinds of mediation, and it's important if you're involved in a conflict and you're looking at this to understand that the interest-based mediation, the mediator's job is a facilitator. Your focus is on the interests of the parties, not the legal rights obligations. You can put that aside. And the mediation is focused on kind of creative options, kind of the win-win, looking for some sort of win-win solution. The evaluative mediation, and those are the kinds of mediations people might have experienced with a retired judge or somebody like that. A lot of the workplace mediations to try to resolve a grievance or to keep things out of arbitration are done that way, and there the mediator actually says, well, this is what I think the outcome is likely to be based on your legal rights, your legal obligations, whatever the information is. And then that is the basis for the negotiating a settlement based on, well, this is what the mediator thinks, they're knowledgeable. The mediations that I've done, and I do a fair bit of work now as a mediator and as an arbitrator, usually involves both of those things. Both interest-based at the beginning to try to open things up and look for a solution. And then ultimately it comes down to the wire and there's, you know, somebody's got to pay somebody else some sum of money, and you get to an evaluation of, well, what is this worth? How much do I have to pay, you know, to stop this fight? And that's an evaluative process. Qualities, you want, if you're involved in this at all, you want somebody with subject matter expertise. You want somebody who knows about, you know, startup companies or technology or whatever the issues are. Generally, I think you want somebody who's going to let people make their own decisions. And in some cases, that's why the retired judges are not the best mediators. There's some that are very good, but there's some that they just want a judge, right? They're going to go in there and they're going to tell you what the answer should be. Some creativity and lots of patience, lots and lots of patience, and willing to let people talk and kind of work with what their goals and objectives are. For arbitration, it's very different. It's like a private litigation. There's some big advantages to it. It's less formal, but you do have to follow some basic rules. It's not necessarily quicker or cheaper, although if it's done right, it should be. But the advantages are you can select the arbitrator so you can get somebody who's going to make a decision who actually knows something about the issues. You're not going to, you know, be randomly assigned, you know, to a judge to deal with your intellectual property dispute who spent their entire career doing criminal law. And it's private. And particularly in the technology field, with intellectual property, with startup companies, keeping it private, keeping it confidential can be critical. If you have a public dispute, if you end up in court, you may win, but by the time you've won, your company may be dead. And so arbitration as a private, kind of confidential process, I think, can be really important. So again, you want somebody with some subject matter expertise. You want somebody who's going to take a firm grip on the process so that arbitration doesn't take 5 years and cost millions of dollars. It should be quick, it should be cheap, but it's not always. If you have the right arbitrator, they can ensure that it is. And somebody who is simply going to be fair. I've seen this a lot of times. Somebody says, well, we want to pick an arbitrator who's going to see things our way and be on our side. No, that's not who you want. You want somebody who is going to be neutral, and you got to convince them that you're right. But if you get somebody who's biased, the whole thing is going to be out the window. Other dispute processes for projects, for joint ventures, for startup companies, for those kinds of things, simply having an informal executive committee process or a formal escalation process, I think is very useful. In a contract, if you're doing a contract that's got a dispute clause in it, you want to have some sort of escalation, some sort of opportunity to talk directly to the key decision maker on the other side before it gets escalated out to mediation or arbitration or goes to litigation or wherever it's going to go. So having some sort of informal or formal process in place, I think, is very useful. But you have to make sure that people are engaged in that process. Projects, I've done a fair bit of work over the last little while in particularly large IT projects or joint development projects, R&D projects, fairly large-scale projects, where the appointment of a project umpire can be very useful to have a quick resolution of, if you've got a long-term project and you know, because you can't nail everything down going into it, that there's going to be disputes along the way, and you don't want them to escalate and blow things up completely, the umpire can help to facilitate or mediate a resolution, or even provide that neutral evaluation or some sort of non-binding or even binding arbitration. This approach has been used for years, for maybe 30 years now, in the construction industry. It's how they resolve disputes. There they call them dispute boards, generally. These are large, hundreds of million, billion-dollar projects. And so they've got a very strict formal structure in place. But it works. And what I've been doing over the last few years is trying to adapt that to particularly the technology sector. The projects aren't as big. They're not billions of dollars, but they might be millions of dollars. And they're long-term relationships. A big IT outsourcing can go for 10 years, and there's bound to be problems. And having an umpire available on short notice to resolve these things can save a project from huge costs in trying to deal with disputes. So it's an idea that I would like to see used more. And if any of you have a big project and want an umpire, come talk to me. Resources. I mentioned getting to yes. And there are a couple others. Getting past no is kind of a sequel. The You Can Negotiate Anything is quite an interesting book. And I like the one called Beyond Winning as well. It's about how to make the negotiation about more than just winning this particular round. And I'm a member. I'm on the board of the ADR Institute of Ontario, and they've got quite useful resources about dispute resolution if you're looking for that. And with that, I'm open to questions. If anybody's got some questions, we probably only have a minute or two left, but
right, we can take one question and then you'll inform me.
Thank you. And I'm happy to stay behind and answer questions or talk to you as well.
Your focus was mainly on the negotiation, which is most often, you talked about the problem-solving area, but most often is on one occasion. But if you're dealing with a person who is focus on power side of things on a continuous basis. Mm-hmm. What are the ways to deal with such a person? If it's a continuous basis, on a continuous basis, how would you deal with the person like that?
Well, as I said, the strategies to respond to their approach. So if it's a, take it or leave it kind of approach, keep suggesting alternatives. Whatever power strategy they're using, there is a counter strategy that you can use. I mean, it depends on how they're doing it, mm-hmm. But there is always a counter approach that takes it out of the pure power relationship, pure power negotiation, and brings it back to a rights-based or some other basis for negotiating. And, they keep doing it over and over again because that's the only way they know how to do it. You have to keep responding to it and responding to it and responding to it. And,
So
either
the next
they'll change
question...
or they won't change. And at that point, you walk away because they're not going to change.
So, and when is that point of the walking away? I mean, is that a personal question or is,
that's
is there
purely
sort of
a personal question?
That's a personal question.
Yeah.
Okay. Great. Thanks.
One can't more? Take one more.
One more.
Okay. Thank you for the presentation. Given the fact that people are different and situations are different, in North America in 2014, do you find that people have a lesser tolerance to engage in interest-based negotiation and want to get into rights or power negotiations far more frequently or sooner into the process?
Yes, there's a tendency to jump right to the answer. And I find that all the time in when I'm doing facilitation or mediation. Nobody wants to spend the time to look for alternatives, to do the brainstorming, to try to better understand what the problem is. They want to go straight to the answer. So they come into the negotiation saying, no, I completely know what the problem is here. I completely know what the answer is here, and I've got it all worked out. And as you say, the only flaw in that approach is that there's somebody on the other side who's got a different problem and a different idea of how to solve it.
True. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you very much, Michael.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Have a good evening.